Okay, everyone, it is 6 p.m. right on the nose, so we are going to go ahead and get started. I want to welcome everyone to the City of Menifee's Parks, Recreation, and Trails Commission meeting. It is Thursday, September 1st, and we are calling this meeting to order, and we'll do so with a roll call, please, from our clerk.
Commissioner Holcomb?
Here.
Commissioner Croy?
Here.
Commission Chair Zimmerman?
Here.
Commission Vice Chair Gidroyce?
Here.
Commissioner Rosen?
Here. Thank you very much. And if we could have Commissioner Gidroyce, Vice Chair Gidroyce, lead us in the flag salute, please.
Please stand and salute the flag. Please begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you. We are now on item four, presentations. So Director Lennox, will you please let us know about 4.1?
Thank you, Chair, and good evening, Commissioners. It's my pleasure to actually invite up Community Services Supervisor Jason Hendricks to introduce a couple of staff. First it will be Joe Solano to introduce a couple of new staff joining our team or promoting within our team. Given some of the recent changes within our organization.
Okay. Well, first of all, I am pleased to introduce our new Parks Supervisor of Maintenance, and that is Bryce Howell sitting over there.
Welcome.
Joining us today, and he's getting his first feel of the commission meeting. Bryce has been here in Menifee since 1990. He started elementary school and went through high school. Here in Menifee, he started working in construction right out of high school, and then he started doing landscape work right soon after that. Then he started his own landscape company, and he had that for about 5 years. Then he decided to, in those 5 years, he decided to prep himself to, you know, get ready to work in the city of Menifee. And such had it, he did get hired as a specialist for the City of Menifee Community Services Department, and he worked here for a year, and he applied for the supervisor's position, and lo and behold, he outshined the rest of the opponents or the candidates that were in the interview, alongside with him. I myself am pleased to have him on board. He's really taken a lot of the little tiny things that daily tests. And he just jumped right into that. You know, he's really helped us in the department, and along with the staff, his staff, you know, keep moving along, especially with these projects that we've had in the last 3 or 4 weeks. That's been great. Also, I'm going to defer to Bryce and have him introduce our newest maintenance specialist also. So, Bryce, please.
Thank you. It's nice to be working with you guys in the commission. It's good to be able to be here, supervise. My family's here, so we use the parks, we use everything here, so it's also good to be here in the city. The person who took my position here as a specialist is Joseph Powell. He's been in Menifee since 2001. What's that? 2007? Sorry. His wife has been involved in the community too. She's the admin manager here at the hospital here in Menifee. So his family's there. He has three kids. Two kids graduated out of the high school here, and he has a younger one at an elementary school here in Menifee. So he was part-time for about 6 months. In that 6 months, he read a lot of books, did a lot of irrigation. We taught him a lot of things, and he really showed that go-get and wanted to learn for that. So then he got hired on. He was the best candidate that we had, scored the highest in our interviews and everything, so it worked out perfect. We knew what we were getting. He already was here on the team a little bit, so hired him on full time. So,
thank you. I just wanted to say a couple of guys that's not here on our team that made me feel welcome as the new guy on. We get along very well. I really like the job and everything that goes along with it. And I feel blessed to be here. And I just want to say thank you guys for having me here tonight.
Well, welcome aboard. I'm going to say that it's reasonable to assume that We're probably going to have some mix-ups with Mr. Howell and Mr. Powell, but we're glad you're on board. And so, Bryce, will you be then presenting to us on a regular basis for maintenance updates?
Yes, I will.
Okay, very good. Awesome.
Congratulations.
Well, yeah.
Thank you.
Yep. We're going to go ahead and come up to the front. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. Let's all go because we'll do a photo op.
Okay, so as everybody knows, every other month or so we do an Employee of the Month to recognize exemplary performance among some of our part-time staff, and today we're joined by two of our best, and actually two of our newest, but they've really come on and done a great job the first few months they've been with us, and we wanted to call them out here today and recognize them for the great job that they have done the past couple of months. We were dark in July, so we didn't get to recognize them then, but we want to definitely do that now. So I'll start with Lori Neneber. Come on up, Lori, please. Lori is kind of an all-utility type person for us. She does everything. She's helped out at the youth programs over at Lazy Creek Recreation Center. She's one of the key staples of the staff members over at Casa Naceros. She helps Aisha out with getting donations. You can stand there. Getting donations for a lot of our events. She makes contact with a lot of the people that come in at the front counter, and we always, and I mean on a regular basis, hear great comments about Lori and her charming personality, her welcoming personality. The seniors love her, which can sometimes be a little bit of a challenge, and she's done a great job of getting them on her side and really letting them know the great programs that we do have. And she takes a lot of pride and passion for what she does, and we just are so happy to have her. So congratulations again, Lori. Next up, another one of our members that kind of has dabbled in a lot of the programs that we offer, Michael Kusan. Come on up, Mike. Michael's been with us for about 7 months, and for the first 6 months and about 3 weeks and 3 days, I thought his name was Kooksen. So we affectionately refer to him as Kooks. But he told one of us that his last name is actually Kusan, so now I have to actually try to get his last name right. But Michael has been, he's somebody that we have on the weekends to facilitate all of our facility reservations, and as you see from the reports that we give, our facilities are always reserved out Saturday and Sunday, and Mr. Kusan is the gentleman that facilitates those rentals, sets them up, works with the customers. We actually get people calling and requesting to have him work the rentals. We were at Applebee's one day having lunch, and somebody said they had had a great time at a rental, and they wanted to know if Michael Kusan would be doing the rental again. So just does a great job and always comes out with a smile on his face, always willing to help, always asking what else he can do to help, and we just really appreciate having him as a member of our team. So thank you, Michael.
And commissioners, while you're returning to your seats on the dais, I wanted to give you just a brief update on additional recruitment that's going on. We recently saw the promotion of our office worker, Edna Aguilar, to our finance department, and as such are undergoing recruitment to fill that vacancy within our own department. So our intent is in the next meeting in October, we'll be able to present you with another new team member.
Thank you. Marty?
Just a question. The second time they took staff away and sent them to finance.
Does that mean we're the incubator for good employees?
Of course it does.
Yes. All right, very good. Good notation, Commissioner Rosen. All right, so with that, we are going to move to item 5, and that is the approval of meeting minutes from our last meeting on August 18th. Do we have any modifications?
Yes.
Okay.
I found three things that need to be fixed. Two are spelling. On the very first page under item 5.1, my name is misspelled. On the second page following that, we have Dean Wetter listed as the president of Valleywide. He is actually the general manager. And then I found one other misspell, which was under item 8.3. Trails is written as trials. But I felt the Dean Wetter was important we get that corrected. Matt Duarte, who spoke, and his name is on there too, he's the president of Valleywide.
President of the board.
The board.
Right. All right. Very good. So, clerk, Madam Clerk, you have those notations and revisions. I wonder if it would be appropriate to include under item 8.1 towards the end, where just above where we motion to receive and file, to also include that commissioners encourage staff to work an amicable resolution, because we did all do that, and that was one of that was our agenda item, is to receive and file and also to provide that. And it was stated in a couple of periodicals in town that we didn't do that, and I want to make it clear that I know for sure that all of us individually said let's work this out. And so if we could say something like that I'd appreciate that being included.
Will do.
All right, very good. Thank you. Any other revisions or modifications?
So with that in mind, I will make a motion that we approve the minutes of August 18th with the modifications noted.
Okay, thank you.
I'll second it.
And I have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, we are approved unanimously. So let's move to item 6. Robert, do we have any agenda changes for tonight?
None.
Okay, thank you. And anybody fill out a public comment speaker slip for item 7?
Yes.
Okay, can we have that, please?
We have Mr. Bill Wright for public comment.
Welcome, Mr. Wright. And you get 3 minutes and come right up to the podium. And
thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, sir.
Well, first of all, I want to thank Menifee, the city of Menifee, the council last year passing the ordinance regarding maintenance of trees in particular, but general, the other ordinance items. In particular, I'm concerned about trees, and I raised my points at that meeting. I'm wondering what the city is doing with regarding to educating homeowners, HOAs, property owners, and especially so-called tree trimmers, landscapers, who come in and trim trees and do it improperly, contrary to the ordinance. And my question of you is, are you getting the populace educated, the homeowners and the other people, managers, educated? And do you have any educational program for landscapers, tree trimmers, and the like? And what is being done to enforce the ordinance? I have understanding that it may not be enforced. And can anybody report errors in pruning? What would be done? And are there any fines to be imposed?
Very good. I want to thank you for coming. And typically we don't answer questions, but you took the time to come here, and so I think it's worthwhile. If our community services director would, I'd appreciate if maybe you could update Mr. Wright on what has taken place as far as public information on those items.
Sure. The city doesn't currently have a program to openly outreach to its residents on tree preservation. We reserve most of that effort for new developments that come in, informing them of our design standards and the intended maintenance of those improvements they put in the ground. To the other point, the other question regarding how enforcement occurs, similar to our code enforcement, that's done on a call and response basis. So as issues arise, they're brought to our attention mostly by residents We go out and investigate and then have a finding. That was similar to what we experienced with the issues along Newport. That was reported to us when we went out, investigated, issued a notice of violation. After that, there's a 30-day period that the owner has to correct those issues. If they don't, then additional fines and or disciplinary action are to follow. That's the typical process.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Were fines actually imposed in those cases?
So we are, the first notice of violation that was issued was to Valleywide for the Newport corridor. They're still within their 30-day period, so we're not at the moment of fines yet.
I see. And so what educational program is there? How are you getting the message out to about this?
As I mentioned, we don't have an outreach program at this time. We have all of our ordinance information is posted online, and we constantly direct our developers to that information. We don't have a clearinghouse of all the tree trimming organizations in town. We focus mostly on maintenance and then ensuring that our new developments abide by the design standards.
Well, I'm concerned about the older ones, which I live in, and we've had in the last 2 years, two landscape companies. One had been in there for 25 or more years, and the other one for 6 months, and we had to fire them because they mispruned our trees. Now, here's a question. If we were to report them, would our HOA be liable for fines, or would the landscaper be liable for fines, or both?
Typically, it would apply to the property owner, and then the property owner could take action against their maintenance provider.
Well, okay, well, here's the problem. Our boards at the time these people were hired were really not knowledgeable about tree pruning, and I tried to educate them, but and even the pruners themselves were not willing to be educated. And so how can an HOA protect itself against unprofessional pruning against the code that you passed a year ago?
Okay, so what I'm going to recommend is that you have this conversation with our staff, and I'm sure that Mr. Solano or Mr. Lennox can provide you with their business card, and you can contact them during the week, and you guys can, they can certainly edify you on all of these questions. I think that would be the right way to take care of this.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah, I appreciate you coming tonight.
Service and contribution.
Thank you, Mr. Wright.
City of Menifee.
Can you guys get a business card for Mr. Wright?
Yeah, and we've been in contact with him.
Okay, yes. Great, thank you. All right, so any other speakers? All right.
None.
Thank you. So we're going to move to item 8.1. It's a discussion item for consideration of a 2016 menorah lighting event discussion. So Robert, can you help us out with
Absolutely.
That?
As the commission may recall, there was a discussion on August 18th during the commission meeting with a motion by Commissioner Rosen to have placed on the agenda a discussion on menorah lighting event in the city for the upcoming meeting. That's essentially what this is. Staff put together a report proposing the opportunity to co-sponsor, and that isn't necessarily in terms of financial support, but it could be in kind, an event for menorah lighting in the city. When that occurs, there's a couple of ways that could happen. One would be as a standalone event, a co-sponsorship could be on a date where there is not already a city activity. Typically, if it's on city property, it would incur some cost and would require city council to approve and appropriate monies for those activities if it was co-sponsored. Alternatively, though, and what staff's recommendation would be is to combine it with what we already have in our Christmas tree lighting event. Essentially holding both events on the same day, same night, same evening. And in that case, the costs would be minimal, if not negated by existing programming and staff that's in place. Now, those are simply proposals, and the commission can advise on any other alternatives to it, but this is a good place to start the discussion.
Great, and just, can you remind us, last year this came to us, but we didn't have enough time really to consider it. So the event was held, but it was held on private property and wasn't a co-sponsorship or partner with the city. Is that correct?
That's correct. It was held at the Town Center Marketplace, I believe. And or sorry, Countryside Marketplace. There was no impact on city resources. I think we did place it on the community calendar for folks who were visiting the website to get and on part of the listserv. So that is also still available, as I understand.
Okay, very good. And so I think Commissioner Rosen was first.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank staff. I mean, it's very generous. Unfortunately, December 10 is a Saturday, and Saturdays are not days that these things can be done. It has to be a different day of the week. No work can be done, and accordingly, no work here either. What I would like to recommend, if the commission would agree, is that once again, we hold it on private property, namely the Countryside Marketplace. But I would request that, one, that it be placed on the calendar of the city whenever the date, I would tell as soon as the date is approved. This particular year, the holiday comes out the exact same time as Christmas, literally starting on December 24th at night. And so, for obvious reasons, no candle lighting is going to be done the 24th, and it wouldn't be done on the 25th. It would either be done on the 26th or 27th, something where it wouldn't impact on anything else. So I would request that that be done. And I would also request that perhaps next year, when people are considering when to do the tree lighting, that a day be picked other than Saturday, perhaps a Sunday, okay, or any other day, so that the candle lighting can be done also on the same time as the tree lighting.
Okay, so just to clarify, you're recommending that this year you continue similar to what you did last year and keep
right.
it on private property?
So we don't
property,
interfere with anything.
But you want to request that the city post it on the city's calendar to help
correct.
You with some marketing? And then we're
for next
requesting
year,
future tree lightings to be, to, for the city to consider it on a day that works.
Well, any day other than Saturday.
Got it.
Okay. We do have a public speaker for this item.
Okay, very good. So let's do a couple of questions up here on the dais, and then we'll open it up to public comment. So Commissioner Holcomb.
Yes, Marty, first of all, thank you for bringing this recommendation to us. I fully support it. Previously, I was wondering, before Bill explained, I was wondering why you suggested that it be on private property. Now I understand your reasoning. But I would hope that we could have it on public property or city-owned property from next year on.
I agree. It should be. There are some 6,000 families, Jewish families, in the area, and yeah, we should do it pretty much the same thing, same time.
And I think the occasion of a menorah lighting is important enough to do it publicly and in sponsorship, whether it be in-kind or financial contributions from the city. So I think this is a fantastic idea. Thanks for bringing it forward.
Commissioner Croy.
Yeah. Can you, it has to be in according to when it actually starts, right? The
light. It has to be somewhere during the 8 days.
Right.
Okay. Normally you'd start it on the first day.
Right.
But, you know, practicality says it's not a good idea.
Right.
So we would do it on a different day.
Next year, do you know what the first day is?
I don't.
Okay.
I don't. Yeah. But just like this, we could arrange with staff for a suitable day. Mm-hmm. You know, if we would just talk about it.
Yeah. Because last year was a very, very successful event.
Oh, yeah, there were a lot of people.
Yeah. And I would encourage us to continue doing it. And I agree that it sure would be nice to get it in over here. But unfortunately, the calendars don't match. So I agree with Mr. Holcomb.
Yeah, Commissioner Holcomb.
Yeah, Marty, is it too late or somewhat impractical to do it on Sunday, December 11th? Are we too far down the road to?
The actual date that it will be done, from what I'm gathering, the rabbi from Temecula is the one who would be officiating. He's planning on bringing a menorah and probably put it up around the 22nd. And then it's an electric menorah, so it would be hooked up with a timer, and it would go on the 24th, even though nobody will be there. It'll go on for half an hour and then go off. The way the holiday is set up, there's a master, and then there are eight bulbs corresponding to 8 days. The master and the first bulb light on the first day, master and the first two on the second day, and so on down until on the eighth day, you have all of them lit, all right? And they're lit for roughly a half an hour or so, okay? And the only event, when I say event, I mean with people being there and all kinds of things like that, everybody will be invited because it's one of those days when you eat a lot of fattening stuff, like potato pancakes and jelly donuts.
Okay, well, that will attract people like me. So, yeah.
And you'll be invited by all means. So it's just to find a day that is compatible. The people at the Country Marketplace, I've spoken to, why can't I think of the first name? Something Schreiber.
Donahue
Schreiber. They're fine with it. But they have to get permission from their three biggest participating companies, like Lowe's. I forget who the other
is. So it definitely has to coincide with one of the days of Hanukkah.
It has to coincide.
Okay. I would recommend we do it on the 26th.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to get the rabbi to, okay? He's doing it in multiple cities. So he's going to try and do different days for different cities.
Got it. Commissioner Holcomb, did you have anything else?
No, that's it.
Okay. Before we take our public speaker, I just wanted to remind the commission that when we're giving direction for these kinds of events, especially events that are religious in nature for different faiths, that we want to be considerate of all faiths. And so when we start to say we're going to do something that's, like what you're proposing, we want to be open to everything and not be exclusive. So, and then the other thing is, it seemed like we may have called it the holiday tree lighting in the past, or is it Christmas tree? It seemed like at one time we had tried to steer away from the word Christmas to not be exclusive and sound like...
Yeah, but you can't do that. It's known for what it is. In fact, look on your screen.
Right, but I'm wondering if the right thing to do is to say holiday tree lighting, and again, it's all about being inclusive of all faiths.
So the history on this, at least during my tenure here in the city, was... And my experience in other agencies is that they typically do use terminology that is non-secular. Holiday tree lighting is what I've been used to in other agencies. Upon coming here, I proposed the same, but I know the management here had preferred, maybe due to tradition, that it be called Christmas tree lighting. So that's what it's been called. The staff and department have really no preference either way, other than to ensure that everyone is welcomed. So
we would be happy to call it whatever it should be called.
Got it. Understood. Okay, let's go ahead and take our public commenter, please.
Mr. Bill Wright.
Thank you. I'm a biologist. I've studied a lot about life, including that about comparative religion. I've taken a course in comparative religion, and it's a very lively, interesting subject. And there are many gods and goddesses in the world, and everybody fights over them. And that's why, first of all, I'm disappointed that you put in God We Trust up here. Last year, the other issue I brought to the council was it should be E Pluribus Unum, the idea of being inclusive, which you stressed this evening. And I would, first of all, say call it a holiday tree. It truly is a secular holiday tree. I grew up in a Christian home, and we called it a Christmas tree. But I think with the diversity of peoples today, it should be called a holiday tree. And if you want to include a menorah on it, it's a religious symbol. I would say don't include that. Don't include Christian symbols, because you're actually opening the door for other religions. You're asking for an oak tree with a mistletoe there for the Druids from the Celtic countries. You're asking for Votan and Nordic and Teutonic gods to come in, or the Greek and the Roman, or the Muslim god to come on. And they're not compatible. They're quite different. And I have a special concern about Israel, about my Jewish friends, and the threat from Islam. Islam is a criminal religion, and our president has opened the door to them in his statement that there should be no ill speaking against Islam. I speak against Islam. If you don't know Islam, and if you're not an Islamophobic, then you have not been doing your homework since 9/11. I've been a citizen not only of Menifee for a number of years, but of New York City, of London, and other places. I've been a citizen of California that was attacked just this past year. It's important to maintain the separation of church and state. And this sign up here is a breach of it. And I think what you're proposing to do here with city property and city money and is wrong. If you want to have something like this, it should be on private property, and I would suggest calling it a holiday tree or something like that. I could go on and on. I have a lot of passion over this. I've read a lot about other religions, about Christianity. I've tried to be a Christian. I'm a Christian apostate, and I'm so glad I am, because most Christians have been very kind to me. I'm so sorry for Islamic apostates, because that religion wants to kill them. So if you're Christian or you're Jewish and you still want to be kind to me, I really appreciate it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for helping us out and being a part of the conversation, Mr. Wright. All right, with that, any other thoughts? I guess we kind of have a direction. Does everyone sort of get a sense of the commission that what Commissioner Rosen's suggestions are? We're in agreement? All right.
It sounds like there was concurrence, so that, I think that's plenty for us to work with.
Perfect. Thank you very much. All right, let's move on. Make sure I got the right agenda item is 8.2, where it's also a discussion item, policy recommendation. It's regarding alcohol vending at city-sponsored events.
Thank you, Chair. And just to refresh your memory just a bit, at the regular meeting on August 17th, the City Council did consider an MOU with Menifee Valley Chamber of Commerce for the revenue share of proceeds collected during special events. Primarily, the MOU was in reference to vendor booth fees. However, there is also within the MOU the option for revenue share on proceeds from alcohol sales. As you all remember, you did also make a recommendation to approve that MOU, and a point of clarification in the MOU is that it was only referencing if there was alcohol sales, not that there would be definitely at all events. So council did review that MOU as well as a brief discussion on the alcohol service and elected to send it back, not the MOU, but the discussion on the policy for alcohol service, send it back to commission for consideration and for a recommendation to bring back to city council at a future meeting. So staff has done a little bit of homework on that and prepared a draft policy for each event, each citywide event we would be offering throughout the year with some set rules for consideration. And I'm going to go through those very briefly. Yes?
Just to clarify, so we're going to make a recommendation. Does it go to planning commission or does it go straight back to council?
Back to council.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. Good. What's on the screen in front of you now is the same that's in your staff report, is a matrix of our signature special events, some of which exist now and some of which would be events that are brand new for the upcoming year. And as you'll see, the first column just the name, but the final right column is whether there's alcohol or not, which is really, I think, at the gist of this policy discussion. For Fall Festival, as you all remember from council's outcome of the last meeting, they did elect to approve the sale and consumption of alcohol at the upcoming Fall Festival in October. And they did also hear testimony from some of the residents, and some of which were from Menifee Valley Chamber, who reiterated that there would be a cup limit during that event. And so that's on there as a yes, but with a cup limit, and to be held at AMR Park. And then moving down, Christmas tree lighting, staff's recommendation. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Can you clarify cup limit just so everyone understands what that means?
Sure, yes. The process for sale of alcohol at an event would include, and on the next slide it gets a little more detail, it would include a beer garden or alcohol garden that's gated in, only one entrance and exit. And those participating would have to buy tickets, drink tickets. And in this case, at this event, they would be limited buying two tickets. So that would be the cap on their consumption for that evening. Moving down, Christmas tree lighting, staff's recommendation is to not allow or authorize sale and consumption at the event. Spring Festival, and that event, as you know from the last item, is at the Town Center Roundabout. The next event would be Spring Fest. It's traditionally a egg hunt and morning in the park, so to speak. And staff is recommending no alcohol sales at that. Music and Arts Festival is an event that we've been sort of gleefully planning for better part of a year and a half and waiting for the completion of the Central Park site. We are proposing alcohol sales and consumption at that event in a designated beer garden. We have not discussed any limits on sales. Typically with the event of that size, with the proper measures in place, open consumption, meaning no limit on consumption. My experience in other agencies has not been an issue, and there's some rules on the next slide that I'll show you will ensure that it's done safely. Independence Day, although we haven't done it recently, the city had participated in some alcohol sales in the past at this event without any incident. Again, the scope of this event and the number of people there, considering the celebration of the season, seemed like a reasonable combination. So staff recommendation is to allow alcohol. Movies in the Park, I think we're on our second year of that throughout the summer. It's a done on a weekly basis between July and August, and staff is not recommending to have alcohol at those. It's primarily for children and families. There isn't a whole lot of other adult activities, as the feature films are mostly animated in nature. And then finally, Summer Concerts is a new event that we want to introduce in the upcoming year. Again, this would be held in the Central Park location on the amphitheater stage that's planned, and would include things like live entertainment, car shows, and we are recommending the sale and consumption of alcohol at that. In the case where we do allow or prohibit those or authorize those, there's some specific rules, and these are within your staff report. All alcohol sales are to be strictly regulated in compliance with the California Department of Alcohol Beverage Control via licensing and permit process. And per the MOU that was approved by council, Menifee Valley Community Chamber of Commerce would be subject to securing those licenses and insurances for those. Excuse me. All sales venues are to be gated and secured under the supervision of trained volunteers of the Chamber of Commerce, with the local police authority, Riverside County Sheriff. Every event that we plan, we invite sheriff, fire, and all the community partners to the table to discuss. There is a operations plan that's part of that planning, and it needs to be signed off and approved by all those agencies prior to us holding the event. That would be true of these as well. Even for the upcoming Oktoberfest, the Sheriff's Department has essentially dictated how many deputies need to be assigned to that area, where they would be placed, and so we would do the same for the rest of the events. Sales would be facilitated through the purchase of tickets at a central sales booth manned and operated by the Chamber of Commerce. As I mentioned earlier, the designated beer or alcohol garden shall be placed in an area as far away as possible from activities specifically tailored for youth and minors in all events, or at all events. Alcohol vendors shall be licensed and certified to pour consistent with TIPS best practices. It's a training for intervention procedures. It's the global leader in education training for responsible service, sale, and consumption of alcohol. As far as we understand, all businesses that have received their ABC license to sale and distribute alcohol in their place of business have to go through TIPS training. And so each of the vendors that could possibly be doing pouring at these events would have to have the same certification. Okay. This is really just to spot anybody who may have had more than they needed and to cut them off. And then finally, alcohol sales should be limited to beer and wine spirits. Hard alcohol sales are prohibited. So that was the extent of the policies that staff's recommending. But of course, as a recommendation to council, the commission is also welcome to add to this or modify as needed.
Excellent, thank you. And please leave this up on the screen, because I know I got a couple things I want to talk about, but let's start with Commissioner Rosen.
The one item that I'm torn with is the first item on the list, the one that was approved by the city council. They took a combination of two events, put them together, and approved the alcohol. I have no problem with alcohol being served in an Oktoberfest, but this is Halloween as well.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. And the Halloween, the contests, the typical season event is children. I would definitely suggest that Fall Festival not contain both items, that they be separated. If you want to have an Oktoberfest, by all means, but leave it just that and don't bring children in to have a Halloween event as well. Let them be separated without the alcohol.
Okay, and Commissioner Gidroy.
The council's already made that decision, so we're not in a position.
For this year, yes.
Yes, but I was reading in the buzz that the publisher is gonna have a separate event in Wheatfield Park just for kids without alcohol as a consequence of that decision. I don't know if you're aware of that.
I was not aware of that.
On a separate date. So they've taken it upon themselves to do something to accommodate the kids.
But unfortunately, what's going on here?
Well, we'd still be having our city event, but they feel like if there's enough people who want to have a non-alcohol in the presence of kids, that's what their event will be for. So I just want to put that information out there.
Okay.
With respect to having a beer garden, I have no objection for that, excepting that I was wondering, going forward, how we're going to handle it if somebody else comes forward and says, I'd also like to have a beer garden. I think we should only permit one per event. And what are we going to have to do? Have a lottery or something? Let's say the baseball or soccer people say, oh, this is lucrative. I'd like to raise some money too. We have to be fair to all organizations that are qualified. So I want to put that out for some thought also. Thank you.
All right. And I'm going to piggyback off that because that was one of my comments. So Director Lennox, could we, on the very first paragraph where it says MVCC are subject to securing, could you say MVCC or other partnering agency will be subject to? And because it may be another organization that, like the Community Cupboard, for instance, at the spring concerts or something like that. And I don't want us to be locked in to only utilizing the Chamber of Commerce as the only ones allowed to partner with the city and have a beer garden or sell alcohol. So.
Yeah, that's actually a good catch. As you mentioned, even on the MOU itself, it does designate that for the Music and Arts Festival, Chamber of Commerce is not the partner for alcohol sales. It would actually, pending an MOU with the Community Cupboard, it would be them. And so I agree, it should probably list any of those agencies. And for the benefit of the MOU that was approved, it's a 1 year commitment with two additional single year renewals that are upon mutual agreement. And so after a year, if the city or even the chamber is not interested in doing it anymore, it's no problem to back out. And typically in other agencies I've seen, if there are multiple groups interested in providing the same service, we would then issue similar to like an RFP. We would request bids to solicit that service to see who had a proposal that was going to be in the best interest for the city and its residents.
Excellent. And again, just for our edification, it's a 60-40 split on the take for alcohol, is that right?
Correct, 60-40 of the net proceeds.
Okay, thank you. Commissioner Croy, I got you.
Yeah, I think the important thing, as Bill said, is to clean up the language here so that it's these policies aren't just for the Chamber of Commerce. It should be all inclusive here, even in paragraph 2 and 3. Have you received any input from fire, police, as far as how they feel about this kind of thing?
I'll actually defer to Jason Hendricks on that.
Thank you. Yes, we've had two meetings since the decision was made by City Council to allow alcohol sales at the Fall Festival by the Chamber of Commerce. And police and fire obviously have their restrictions and their guidelines that will have to be met, which Robert illustrated here in this document. The sheriff's simple response is that we have to meet those requirements. Basically, they're typically at our events, they have staff there for, they call them foot patrols, staff to go through and make sure that the crowds are not congregating one place. Maybe there'd be a fight or anything like that. In this case, there's going to be three deputies assigned specifically to the beer garden. So that's going to be an additional measure, in addition to the fact that the chamber is actually providing additional security, which is going to be MPS, a private security company. So it'll be well secured, and there's a lot of fail safes that are in place. Fire has limitations, but not necessarily specific to the alcohol area, the beer garden. Theirs is more related to the overall event, such as having enough fire extinguishers, having AMR on standby, which we've already secured. So again, with sheriff and fire, their main things are making sure that their requirements that they have for all events are met. And they're very involved in the process. As Robert mentioned, there's an operations plan, an ops plan that has to be submitted by September 14th. They review that very thoroughly. It's about a 30-page document with maps and everything else you can think of in there. And at that time, they'll raise any additional concerns that they have. But they're very involved in the process. They attend all of our committee meetings, which are about every other week. And then when we get closer to the event, we have them every week on site and in our office.
Right. Thank you for that clarification. Three police officers, that's our entire police force. it sounds to me like, you know, all due caution is being exercised here. So my feeling is I really don't have a problem with it, as long as we're taking these steps to, you know, make sure everything's handled.
I agree. Commissioner Holcomb.
Yes, I'll tell you, even though I no longer consume alcohol, I have to say that I still support residents' rights to do so, especially since it's still legal in America. Nevertheless, I do empathize with Marty's position, and perhaps something can be incorporated into policy that discourages, say, the Chamber of Commerce and other organizations from mixing events that is a reasonable assumption that children will be well represented at. I think something should be incorporated into code that discourages that, because I don't think it's fully appropriate to sell alcohol, allow the sale of alcohol at events where we know a lot of children are going to be at. And I think it was a bad mixture this year, but perhaps it can be addressed properly in future years.
All right, Commissioner Rosen.
Thank you. Just one question of Jason first. The fire department signed off on a one entrance only?
Are you talking about for the actual entrance to the beer garden? There's going to actually be two entrances. Uh-huh. Both will be staffed by either MPS or Riverside Sheriff personnel. Okay. And it's an entrance and an exit point. It's not a one-way, basically.
Okay.
That was their requirement.
All right. I admit I'm torn between the idea of teaching children that they can have fun unless they drink, at the same time that you want to allow 501c3s to be able to make some money that so that they can do the good they do. So on that, I'm going to take a type of vision where I'll back off and look and see how it goes. Why would movies have not have alcohol, but a concert would? Both are going to have children, lots of them. So I don't know if that should have the beer garden, but as I said, I'm torn.
Commissioner Gid Royce.
Thank you. I agree with Commissioner Holcomb, and I was at the event last year, and it was primarily children. And it's disappointing to think that it has to be changed around because of this, but it has. And I would like to also ask, how are these police being paid for? We're always hearing about a budget crunch on the city. We're talking about extra police. And is there anything in that memo about unforeseen expense that the city might have to be reimbursed for, say something should occur?
When you mentioned something should occur, I think there's a lot of, there's a lot of interpretation there. So whether it's a beer garden or not a beer garden, if something were to occur in the park during the event, there could be a cost associated with which the city would have to absorb for certain. So I think it sounds like you're really talking about the added risk of it, right?
Oh yeah, and let's say somebody was to decide to steal the till. Obviously, there's a tie back to the fact that these are the folks who were hosting this event. Right. But in the case of how many officers we're talking about, how is that being paid for? Is that coming out of the city's pocketbook, or is it a shared expense? What's the setup?
Yeah, some of it is shared with the Menifee Chamber of Commerce, and then part of it is within the city's contract with the with the Sheriff's Department. There is additional rates for overtime, just as when we run an event. Overtime scheduling of those officers are not necessarily part of the contract amount. This is another not part of contract amount expenditure. So there's some absorption by the city to ensure that this happens. I'll point out, though, that's the purpose in the 60-40 revenue split, is that it fully covers the cost of those additional officers and then some.
Thank you.
Yes.
Commissioner Rosen?
How can you possibly ensure that people are not going to abuse the tickets? I mean, I don't drink. Well, my friend here goes and buys his two tickets, gets me to buy two tickets. I don't drink, so I give him my tickets. Now he's got four. He could do that with as many friends as he wants. How do you, with so many people being present at the independence celebration, you're expecting 20,000 people. How are they going to ensure that person A isn't drinking in excess?
So for the independence celebration, staff is, right, staff is not recommending a drink limit at that event. This is where the tips training and certification becomes very important. Anyone who's pouring the alcohol will have to do an assessment, a spot assessment of the customer to make sure that they are capable of consuming more. And if they're not, then they simply tell them, I'm sorry, I can't serve you. It's the same thing that occurs when, you know, in a restaurant establishment or bar, if someone has consumed too much, the bartender will refer to their training and tell them, I'm sorry, I can't serve you anymore. That's the that is a certain level of trust that this policy implies. And so it's something you will want to take into account when making a recommendation for City Council. When it comes to the Oktoberfest, where there is a drink ticket limit, you're absolutely right. They, someone could come in and cheat the system and buy additional tickets and give them to their two tickets to their friend. And you know, when it's all said and done, the one friend who wants to drink may have six tickets in their hand. That's a possibility for certain. And the only thing I can say to that is that staff can ensure that or can remind the Chamber of Commerce to look out for those repeat offenders. The beer garden in itself is not a big area. And so we were confident we'd be able to determine everyone who's coming in and out. But the abuses are realistic. They can exist. The best thing we can do is watch out for them.
Could I just answer that?
You can.
First, I would definitely recommend that there always be a limit in every event. That would be my recommendation. Whatever that recommendation is, I'm not making the recommendation, but I'm saying we should have one, whether it be two drinks or three drinks or 12 drinks, but whatever it is, we should have a limit.
There is one other opportunity. I think Jason had brought this up in the past when we were planning this. Is you know, traditionally it's been a ticket-based system. Let's say for Oktoberfest, if someone were to come in, they purchase a wristband that is, you know, its value is equal to two drinks, and then at the pour stations, they simply punch a hole in the wristband each time they get a drink. Well, you can't transfer the wristband because you have to cut it, and then once it's cut, it's no longer valid. That's one way to ensure there's no cheating of that system. Hand stamps, you know, once you give your ticket, the pourer will stamp your hand and that's it, but folks can wash those off, and there's a lot of things that can happen. We know that. You know, but to your comment about limiting the number of drinks at all the other events, again, that's within the purview of the commission to make a recommendation to council. Staff, at least my experience has been that in other agencies, there has not been limits, and there's still been a very successful and safe event. The benefit in it is certainly providing additional revenue offset costs related to the event. But again, it's a policy decision, and staff will follow whatever policy is adopted.
Commissioner Gidroyce.
Thank you. Robert, you just answered Marty in the way I was going to about wristbands and hand stamps. In my experience, I've seen those both used. I do happen to agree with Commissioner Rosen. I think that in all the events where alcohol will be served, and we haven't decided which, that there should be a cup limit. And I would suggest it be two cups so that we are bringing people inside the range of what is considered the legal limit for driving. It may not be necessary, but I think ethically the city should take the high road on that.
Do we have any public speakers on this, Madam Clerk? Okay. So we need to make some decisions here because we're going to send a recommendation to the City Council. So, Robert, do you mind, or Madam Clerk, do you mind going back? There you go. And, you know, to me, I really think you did a great job on putting this together. It sort of reflects exactly my feelings. You put yeses where they need to be and noes where it's appropriate to put noes. I don't like the cup limit thing. That's just me. Some people, especially if you go to a concert, and I know one of those things is a music and arts festival in May that's proposed when the amphitheater gets built. There may be someone who enjoys to have a few beers when they're listening to rock and roll and or blues or whatever it is. And so, you know, I think there will be a lot of people that feel like we're being a little bit draconian and telling them they can only have one or two or three cups or something like that. That's just my opinion. I don't like the cup limit. But again, we're all sharing our thoughts and we may differ, and it's okay. Sometimes we can even send a recommendation that's split. So, Robert, did you want to chime in there?
Yeah, and in fact, sending a recommendation that's split is okay as well. We can easily add a column to this that says, you know, X number of commissioners in favor of a cup limit versus no cup limit, you know, and provide that detail to the council.
Okay. You guys want to take that vote on cup limit first, and we'll do a few others as well?
As a point of discussion, it also kind of depends on the length of the event, too. If you have a concert that starts at 4 in the afternoon and can go to 10 at night,
or an all-day concert.
Or an all-day event where you have several acts,
yes.
Then the cup limit doesn't make sense.
Right.
Because, you know, so...
So at this point, the only one with a cup limit is the Fall Festival. Mm-hmm. So... I guess I'm okay with that one if that's the only one, but I don't want to see cup limits added to these others for that reason right there. It may not be appropriate to limit it on an all-day event.
Then how do we know if they are an all-day event?
We can provide that detail. For example, Jason knows the exact hours of each of these and the future events as well. We know approximately how long they would be. As an example, the summer concerts are usually like a 6 p.m. to 10 p.m. The Independence Celebration is 4 p.m. until about 9:30. The Music and Arts Festival would be an all-day thing. That's like a 10 a.m. until 10 or 11 p.m. And then the Fall Festival is I believe, 4?
2 p.m. to 9 p.m.
2, that's right. We expand. So 2 to 9. So there you go.
And some of the planning for, like, the summer concert, we included things like a car show to happen even before the concert starts. And so it could extend the day and therefore be appropriate.
And when we get Bruce Springsteen to show up, it's going to be a six-hour concert.
All right. Commissioner Gidrose.
I would say for extended events that are going to long last a number of hours, we'd have a greater cup limit, that's all. Because the human metabolism is going to absorb the alcohol over the course of the day. We'd also could have to take in the weather. I mean, if it's a hot day or a cold day, it'll affect people too. But I would just suggest we would have a higher cup level. That's my take on it.
So you're saying up it to 3 or 4, something like
yeah,
that?
Yeah, if you have a long event, we'd have to figure out the math, but I'm just suggesting if it's over four hours. Yeah, if it's over 4 hours. And let's say we might allow 4 cups. I'm not a scientist when it comes down to this. I saw the table that the DMV has. We could work off of that. The research has been done. But I'm not saying, I don't agree with unlimited alcohol available to anybody. I don't think that that's a position the city should take. It's just a matter of ethics. And also, we just spent a lot of money on our master plan, and it talks about health and nutrition and all those good things, and never any of those focus groups we had talked about, I'd like to have a drink. And I just think that the image of the city, which is also discussed in there, should be considered. And I think by showing restraint, the city would show a better image to the public. That's my thoughts.
Well. We're going to kind of go through some of these things. And so I guess maybe what we'll do is, because you threw some variables in there now, so it's getting a little squirrely. It's not going to be a yes or a no anymore.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's a recommendation, so we don't have to nail it down to specifics, but we can give them some range to talk about. Because I'm sure the council will want to keep talking it over, too.
If you're going to do a two-cup limit per four.
You're going to do a two-cup limit for 4 hours. So if the event is going to be beyond 4 hours, you up it to 4 cups. Mm-hmm. I'm perfectly agreeable with that.
Commissioner Holcomb.
I do not agree with setting cup limits because, as mentioned, there are so many variables here. I think to a certain extent we should trust the agency involved. And if they mess it up, council always retains the right to not approve alcohol for the following year or the next time that they put on this event. That's the ultimate point of accountability, is if they screw it up, council always retains the right to not allow it the following.
Well, it's going to come back to us, I hope.
I would recommend that. Exactly. But those options always exist. I try to err on the side of trusting people more, you know, notwithstanding the fact that I work for a government agency, which doesn't trust people a lot. So I recommend that we set the example by trusting people more.
I agree with that.
I would agree to that, too. I think the discussion is a valid one, a completely valid one. But when we see the policies here where we're taking all due caution, we can micromanage it to death. And I just think that it's not necessary. I think that 99.9% of people act reasonably in these situations. And if you're taking your family to a concert, you're not going to, you know, get inebriated because it's embarrassing. That's most common sense.
And I appreciate that staff has talked about sitting down with police and sheriff and fire and talking about event planning. Mm-hmm. The fact that you're considering, you know, having a private security as well. And also, you know, I'm sure that we're going to exercise intelligent discretion when it comes to placement of the beer garden away from kids' jumpers and the things that are going to be there. I mean, obviously, smart planning is going to really play a factor in ensuring that some of the concerns are mitigated. So with that, it sounds to me like Commissioners Holcomb, Croy, and myself are okay with what's staff has proposed. Is that correct? And are you guys wanting to do something more and adding some cup limits and things like that?
I am okay with particular events that are listed, the way they're listed, the yeses and the noes.
Okay.
I do believe there should be cup limits, and I believe it should be dependent upon the length and time of the event.
Okay.
Half day versus a whole day kind of mentality.
If I can make a recommendation, I think you're right, Chair, that there seems to be a consensus with three commissioners about representing it the way it is on the screen. And then relative to the other concerns, I heard earlier, two cups for 4 hours or less of an event length, anything greater than a four-hour event, adding two cups. So for a total of four cups. And it sounds like that's what the recommendation was there. Is that correct?
That's right.
Okay. So
and I would agree with that, yeah.
Okay. And so for that recommendation, a vote or a consensus from the commission about what this... So for the first option, what's on screen, we have a 3-2. For what was alternatively proposed for the yes events, is it a 2-3, or is there some other mix?
So I'm okay with the way it's proposed without any adding any limits.
Okay.
What about Croy?
Yes.
So it's 2-3.
All right. So we'll present to council both scenarios, 3-2, no limit, as it's presented here.
Yes.
And then with the limits, 2-3.
Correct.
Okay.
Thank you for having
one question. Hypothetical. Person goes to the event, gets drunk, has an accident, kills someone. Who's liable?
The person who did the killing.
What about the people that were giving them the drinks?
So similar to when a person consumes too much alcohol at a place of business, a bar, a restaurant, the bar and restaurant are not, they're not held accountable for what that person did once they left that property, especially since they've cleared certification on tips, also have their ABC license for handling and pouring. They have insurance too in case someone from the public, say someone who was, you know, injured as well, wants to come back and file a suit against them, their insurance would cover that as well. And it's precisely why we've asked the Chamber of Commerce to carry insurance for their activities at the event too.
I was always under the impression that you go for the deepest pockets.
Anyone can sue anybody for anything.
But the city is making money on the deal. And because they're making money, they should be liable. I'm not an attorney, so
this,
I would get that cleared up.
Well, we actually did, and I'm glad you asked the question. We inquired with the city attorney. They essentially said because the actual sales and pouring is not done by the city, we don't have any culpability in it. And that's why if you go to any other agency, any other public agency, you will not find them doing the direct sales. They always either have a third party like nonprofit, or they've hired a concessionaire who takes on all responsibility for that.
Just to back up what you said, at the council meeting, the city attorney was asked, and he said there was no liability if it were to occur. A person would have to be falling down drunk, from what I've read, before they could be liable. And the issue that you're talking about, Marty, back east, let's say you were in New Jersey, you would be liable if you were a city or even a party host. But it's just different laws to different states.
Okay, so I think we have our direction and we're able to move on. Everybody agree?
Yep.
All right. Thank you. Good talk, good discussion. I learned a lot. All right, our next item is 8.3, our Quimby Ordinance Amendment. And this is back to us and looks like we're sort of there.
Yep. It's pretty straightforward. I think at the last meeting, Commission's recommendation, at least concurrence, was to remove the section 9.55.115 from the Quimby Ordinance pertaining to the credit of excess park dedication. Attached to the staff report is the red line that shows the removal of that section. Essentially, it would revert back to what it was prior. If that is the recommendation from the Commission, there's a little bit of a process to move that forward. There would be a public hearing and a DCA adoption by Planning Commission, which includes a 14-day notice and advertising. And then similarly, if they approve, Planning Commission approves that, then another public hearing with an introduction and first reading at City Council, and then a second reading following that meeting 2 weeks later with another 14-day advertising period before it becomes adopted by City Council and then amending the code as it's currently written.
Great. So we'll go to Planning Commission from here, correct?
Correct, yeah.
Well, and I don't know if any of you guys want to comment first, but I got a couple things I want to say. So I'm reading in the staff report the discussion, and it's talking about that commissioners now feel that the section provides too much benefit to the developers who may look to utilize banking park credits. And I don't want that to be the way it's described to the Planning Commission and to the City Council. We're not trying to take away benefits to developers or something like that. I hope that it, and maybe it's going to require myself or some other Parks and Rec commissioners who might need to come and speak to the Planning Commission, unless your staff report clarifies a little better kind of the reason why we are encouraging this to be removed, such as a better way to say it would be when a development receives an overage in park dedication, it is a bonus for the residents. And as I want it to be explained, I think the only way to do it is to verbally explain it, but it's similar to when extra parking spaces are provided at commercial projects. It was kind of the same reasoning. Such extras are often viewed as density trade-offs during an entitlement or approval process. So there may be something in the project that's denser than a planning commissioner or council person wants to see, but because they're offering an extra acre, it's kind of the shoehorn that helps the shoe go into it, or foot go into the shoe. So, when credits are purchased by a second development that's nearby, that neighborhood suffers the loss of park space because that developer can build a substandard park and no park at all and justify it by paying the first developer because he's banked those credits. And I would rather see those Quimby fees be paid to the city as opposed to going to the first developer. So again, in my opinion, that first developer who has the extra acres of park that he's dedicating, the excess, it's seen to me as a bonus, similar to extra parking spaces at a commercial site, as opposed to something that needs to be bought and sold as a commodity.
So we can easily reflect it as a bonus, and we'll be able to pull the exact language you mentioned when referencing it. That's not an issue. I do want to highlight, though, that the in a situation where a developer has purchased credits from a neighboring development who had over-dedicated and received bank credits for, that new neighborhood, that new subdivision, isn't losing anything because the acreage that they're essentially purchasing already exists in the neighboring community. So there's no shortage going on to that new community. It's adjacent to them. It's just not immediately outside of their doorstep. That's the spirit of it.
It's up to 2 miles away, though, mm-hmm. right?
That's correct.
So I don't know if anyone's going to walk 2 miles mm-hmm. to play for 15 minutes at a playground. That's why I want to encourage as many parks in as many neighborhoods. I think the best projects have parks in them. And to start creating ordinances that almost encourage a developer to say, you know what, it'd almost be easier for me to pay the first developer and just not even build any parks, and I'll just get a higher yield by putting in homes and no park at all in that community. And they can walk 2 miles if they want to go to a park. And to me, that just isn't healthy living and what our vision is, or my vision is, I guess. I can't speak for everybody, but I've heard that said by others that, you know, good neighborhoods have parks.
I agree.
And I think that by removing this language, I think the net result will be that the city will benefit, and we will receive extra acreage, and we will then receive, if another developer builds a project with that's short, that extra Quimby fee will be paid to us in lieu of, instead of to some other developer. So what we've done is we've created a break-even situation as opposed to the ability to receive a bonus or an extra benefit. So it's in. And that bonus and extra benefit is all about parks and trails. Because if he's paying us Quimby, we can build new trails and we can build new facilities and we can use that to create new amenities for those neighborhoods that might be getting shorted.
Well, the Quimby fees that are collected can only be used for acquisition, not for improvement. So that's the only variance.
We can build a new trails at or buy property for.
Buy property for, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Commissioner Croy.
Yeah, I'm in complete agreement with Bill. I do agree that the language should be softened, if you will. I mean, if that's what we're looking for. But I do agree that with what Bill said, in eliminating this, it really gives us the incentive to create the spaces that we need so desperately in this city. We just have to take advantage of every opportunity to create parks, regional and local, and to allow this kind of wiggle room, if you will, is counterproductive to what our goal is.
And I mean, I've always looked to our park staff as kind of being the champions of parks, and look for every opportunity we can to build as many parks and have as many recreational opportunities. And so it frustrates me that you guys, that staff disagrees. It says right here, staff's recommendation is in disagreement with this. And so I don't understand it. And I really want to have you tell me that, say the words, we don't want the most parks for our community, and I'll get up and leave the room right now.
Mm-hmm. No, staff does disagree with the recommendation from commission, but the commission, as you know, the commission sets some policy, makes recommendations on policy. We'll follow whatever that policy is. The basis for the disagreement is that we believe that by incentivizing banking of those credits, it's going to encourage more of those developers to build larger parks instead of several small ones within each tract's community. right, which then dice it, it creates too much division, split of resources when we're doing maintenance, and doesn't give us the opportunity to invest in larger regional parks, which was an outcome of one of the master plan findings. So in other words, if you were going to, if a developer was going to over-dedicate parkland by however much, 5 acres, 10 acres, whatever it might be, and then be able to bank those and sell them to someone nearby, that developer nearby obviously wouldn't be looking to build a park or to dedicate park land, because that park land is already congregated in the neighboring community. So we're reinforcing the idea of having them build larger parks in single locations instead of several smaller parks spread out. That's the basis for staff's recommendation, but again, staff will follow whatever policy decision is made.
Okay, no, I see the logic in encouraging developers to build the largest parks that they can, and maybe it's a way to have those kinds of regional athletic facilities and things like that. So I appreciate that comment. Again, I feel pretty strongly about this, and I guess my fear is that as it gets presented to other commissions and council, that it's going to lack that sales pitch and the merits for what we're trying to say today. And so I got a feeling I'm going to be standing at the podium at the Planning Commission meeting to explain to them, because I don't know that the staff report's going to sell it the way we are. So
I'd be happy to share a draft of it with you before we take it.
All right, I appreciate that.
Mm-hmm.
I'll share with you some of my rantings.
I'd like to have that draft shared with all the commissioners. And I support Bill's point of view also.
Yeah, so do I.
We're not under the gun. There's no great big hurry to do this. So can we continue this and have it come back reworded and have us look at it again and bless it before it goes off?
What you're suggesting is a wording of a staff report, not the actual ordinance, right? So it doesn't necessarily have to come back as an item unless you really want it to. In which case, I would say under future agenda items, you make that request, is that we'd like an item to come back that proposes language for what will go in front of Planning Commission and subsequently the City Council representing this item and the change to the development code.
Are you okay with that?
Oh, I'm fine with it, yeah.
All right. Commissioner Rosen?
Are there any talks coming up now? Are there any parks coming up
with overage?
With overage?
The only one, or I should say two, that are even close, one is Menifee Heights, which has a slight overage, and the other is Cimarron Ridge. Okay. Only one has even inquired about the option of banking credits. The other has not.
That's why I was asking, because I think maybe we need to try to cut this fast, get it out of the limelight before they start trying to use it.
Yeah, so for the one that is showing an overage currently and interested, it's an overage of, I believe it's less than an acre. It's fairly small.
Like, in other words, we would have gotten it anyway if there wasn't an ordinance.
Possibly.
That's the bonus that I'm talking about, that we're cutting our ability to receive.
Perhaps what you suggested, speaking to the Planning Commission before, when it gets to them,
yes,
is a good idea. Also, if you would go over rewording of the staff report,
sure,
with Robert, we all trust you to do that properly.
I'd like to see it.
Yeah. So we'll bring it back. How about you and I get together, we'll rework the language and then bring it back to us, and we all see it at our next parks meeting. Again, we're not in a hurry, Marty. Okay. There's nothing pressing.
Yeah.
All right, anything else? You good? All right, everybody's good?
So nothing has to be done with it.
Yeah, so we're gonna just continue this item and bring it back with some rewording. All right, so let's move on to Community Services Director comments. Item 9.
Just a brief update on Parks in Progress. Some of these are pulled over from the last meeting. Hidden Hills Park, as I mentioned before, is in its fifth round of plan checks. They actually were due today, but I know that between Community Service Department and Engineering, we need a little more time. We have quite a bit of plans to go through. We'll be submitting the comments back to the developer before the end of next week. Assuming there are no significant changes, they may be in a position to submit Mylars on their next submittal. So that's good news. The lakes, as you know, is under construction. That's number 3 on the list. I haven't gone by recently, but I imagine they're getting fairly close to completion. Cimarron Ridge, we're still trying to work out a development agreement with them, and the latest news is that they are protesting a requirement for athletic field lights at the site.
Can you tell us why?
The interpretation from the developer is that inclusion of lights will exceed really what their budget is for construction, and so they don't want to do that. The ironic part of development agreement, though, is that this is the stage where we would include some sort of conceptual design, and spell out all the amenities that would be in there. So this, they essentially don't want to. They feel that it'll cost too much. The point staff's made, though, is that, you know, it's quite a large facility, 10 acres. It's ideal for sports field lighting, especially under the circumstances and outcomes of our park master plan.
Agreed.
The Evans Park site, we are working on a new conceptual and also appraisal of the vacant lots just north of the land the city does own. We have selected a firm to do the appraisal work, and then we've also selected a firm to do the conceptual design work. And then finally, Cottonwood Park, we did receive just this week, I believe it was either yesterday, we received plan check 5. And so we'll be reviewing those, and assuming they've covered all comments, they would be in a good position for Mylar signings soon too.
That one is near Evans Ranch School?
It's near Evans and Newport. So it's the one that's sort of shaped like a dog leg around the basin, just off of Newport.
Across from Case and Aceros.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I do have a question on 19 Cantilena. That's a, you know, long awaited project. Are they making any progress moving forward?
Not anything recently, no. Not since the last time you all reviewed it.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
And I'll defer to Jason for 9.2.
Thank you, Robert. Good evening once again, commissioners. Just to review, we had a very successful month of August in the Recreation Division. You'll see some of the highlights in front of you and then a more detailed report in the memo with all of our monthly numbers. But just to highlight a couple of things, we started our Tiny Tot program back up at Lazy Creek after the summer was off, and happy to report that all of the sessions and all of the classes are completely full. We have a waiting list for most of them now. So that continues to be a very popular program. We have some very high quality teachers, and we've been able to enhance some of the programming there with some of the equipment that we bought since we've taken it back in-house as an in-house program. Our contract classes continue to rise. We've added a huge slate of new classes, including ballet, folklorico, piano lessons, several new arts classes. So those have been rising in popularity, so we're happy about that. We just started reallocating out the athletic fields to all of our user groups. They did a great job of putting in all their paperwork, and it was all checked out. So we used our formula to allocate the fields, and most of the fields are now being used pretty much all evening with the lights, of course, and then the fields that aren't on the weekends for games on Saturdays and Sundays. Also wanted to highlight, we recognize one of our staff members, Michael Cousin, for the Employee of the Month this month. And the numbers speak for themselves. We had over 21 rentals, indoor rentals alone, this past month in August. At Case and Aceros and at the West Annex also. So that's pretty, I think that's one of our highest numbers that we've had in terms of the monthly numbers for our rentals since we've been a department. So we're happy about that as well. And then moving on to the special events update. Today, I was happy to see Chair Zimmerman at the Safe Seniors Active Fit Enrichment grand opening, which is part of the Living Healthy Building Community Program. Huge thank you to Joe Solano and Bryce Howell and their team for putting out all the hard work and getting the equipment installed at Lazy Creek. If you haven't had a chance to go by, I highly encourage you to do that. There's a walking trail, and then there's four, soon to be five, pieces of equipment, outdoor fitness equipment out there for folks to use. And it just looks fantastic. And already seeing a lot of people. I drove by a little bit earlier on in the day, and there's already people on it using it, not abusing it, which is also good to see. So we encourage all residents to participate in that. The senior portion of this is that seniors are able to check out a wristband, a Fitbit. It's not an actual Fitbit brand, but it's similar to a Fitbit that they can use to track their steps, calories burned, and heart rate. And what they'll do is they'll check that out by leaving an ID or something valuable we'll know they'll come back for. They'll be able to use one of our Fitbits, track their steps, report it back to staff, and then we'll have monthly contests so people know if they're achieving their goals. In addition to that, we opened up our community garden today. Again, thanks to Joe and his team and Bryce for putting in new garden plots. One of the cool features that you'll want to check out is we added a teaching plot. So one of the plots is there specifically for our master gardeners out of UC Riverside to come in and show folks how to do successful planting of fruits, veggies, and just different plants. So great partnerships going on and just an overall great opportunity. So hopefully you guys will come and check those out. So that grand opening went really well. A lot of people in attendance for a 10 a.m. Ceremony. The Menifee Valley Health Systems were very happy with what they saw. So hopefully we'll be able to go after some additional funds for additional healthy living equipment out there at other parks as well. Also on to special events, one thing that's not listed here is our Youth Advisory Committee interviews. Commissioner Gidroyce has volunteered to be one of the interview panelists. It's still open, so if any of you gentlemen are still interested, please let me know and I'd be happy to add you to the panel. We have 14 applicants, so we're really excited about the turnout representing all the different high schools and including two colleges. The assessment will be a group project in which the panelists will review and ask some important questions to make sure that we have the right kids. 11 will be elected and 3 will be alternates. So there will be, it will be a fairly competitive process. And that'll be on Tuesday, September 6th. So as soon as we come back from 4 to 6 at the West Annex. So again, please see me after if you're interested in volunteering for that. And then on September 13th, we have our La Ladera potential field lighting informational meeting. Bruni's been working really hard on a grant to potentially get lights out at La Ladera for extended use of athletic fields. We're going to hold a community meeting, which is part of the grant requirement, which we would do anyways, to just to get the resident feedback on what lights would mean in their community and also to answer questions from the user groups that would eventually use those facilities or that facility for further use. And then on Sunday, September 18th, we have our punt, pass, and kick competition. Similar to the pitch and run that you guys remember, we had several participants go all the way onto the All-Star game. This is a football version of that, punting, passing, and kicking, as the name says. That'll be at Audie Murphy Ranch Sports Park from 4 to 6 on September 18th. So looking forward to having some kids come out and compete and hopefully go on to the finals of that as well. Then we have our detachment informational meeting, a chance for residents to come out on September 27th at 6 p.m. at Casa Naceros and learn about the detachment process, ask questions, let their concerns be known. So we look forward to folks coming out for that. Let's see. And then we have another potential improvement meeting on October 3rd, which will be potential Lazy Creek improvements, which we're Bruni again is going to be working on a second grant for that to potentially get some new improvements, including a ping pong table, an outdoor ping pong table, which I know will be very successful. And possibly pickleball courts as well. And we'll get into some of the amenities as we get closer to that. October 22nd, we have our anti-bullying summit that our Youth Advisory Committee kids will be going to and staff will be presenting at. So we're excited to get some more teen programming going and have them experience some ways that they can reduce bullying in their communities. That's at the Ontario Convention Center. It's part of a regional SoCal teen group. And then, of course, the Fall Festival on Saturday, October 29th. And I believe that is all, so if I'd be happy to answer any questions any of you may have about any of the events or programs.
I think we're good.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, Commissioners. Again, thank you for being here and Commission and Chair, as I remember, for attending the SAFE project that we grand opened today. Community improvement projects that we've been working on, which is this one. It's taken quite a bit of time for for staff, in-house staff, to do a lot of this project. So we, you know, as Jason was mentioning, we had the two areas, KC Center Garden that we were working on, and we also had the Lazy Creek Park component of the project. The KC Center, we did all the raised planters in the gardens and get that ready to go, along with the irrigation system that goes with each one, the benches and the signs and the message boards that we put up for their new soil, the pavers. And then at Lazy Creek, we did the 480-foot DG walking trail or walking path on the outside to complete the loop through the park once you come up from Casey Center. That one, and then we had to modify the irrigation system along the way. They poured the concrete pads with five stations with the footings and all that. And of course, it was over 100-degree weather within that time. We have some slides here, the before and after. As you can see, the top row is the before, where the DG trail is eventually going to go in. Staff cleared out the shrubs and kind of pre-prepped the area for a contractor that came in and put in the mow curbing and then the 4 inches of stabilized DG. And the very bottom right, you'll see the finished product. So that just really cleaned up that, opened up that area of the park itself. Just by looking at the top left picture, you can kind of see where you have a lot of hiding spots and dark areas at night and stuff. So they just really opened that up for the park itself. The picture on the top left, that's where it does a 45 and it goes back into the street. I believe it's Oxnard. The trail, the center top, it's just looking back at the trail, looking at towards Lazy Creek. And then you'll see where we dug the hole for the footing on the top right. And then the staff is in there pouring concrete and getting that ready for the machines themselves to come, exercise equipment to go in. So on the center bottom row, you can see where the four bolts, where the systems would do attach. And then we also ordered the plaque to commemorate the walking trail for the VHS gentleman that they memorialized for this. The pictures there, you see the two message boards that we put in along with the pavers at the bottom so the seniors can see what the activities are or when staff posts things that need to be done. You also see the planters there that were installed. And there's pictures of the pieces of equipment there that were installed. And then you can see I added that bottom left picture there so just give us an idea what the guys were over there working on in the middle of the afternoon, getting the pieces of equipment going. Again, it's just it was just a really hard project to coordinate. You get the pieces of equipment delivery date, and coordinate with the contractors, the DG, and then our staff. And our staff went out every morning and did their kind of routine, regular maintenance, and checked all their sites. And then we came out and started working on this project. So I just want to recognize all the staff for the time and effort that was put in to meet the deadline for today's grand opening. On the next slide, on the division report for the work orders, you can see we're kind of at an 87% completion overall for these last July and August. 79% for this last month, and that was just due to the little bit of the work that they've done as far as the on the SAFE project, but that'll be caught up here in a week or so. These were not emergency work orders, but they'll be able to catch up with that, like I said, in about a week. So next month, those numbers should come up, the percentage of completions on work orders. And that's all I have.
Excellent. Thank you, Mr. Solano. And will we be hearing from Maintenance Division at all, or no?
I'm sorry, I incorporated that whole the project there to that. We really didn't really have a lot of time to go out and work on other little special projects that we've done the last couple of months. Okay. We concentrated on this project here. So I know we have another one coming up, AMR, to remove some a slope. So that'll be another big project for us too. But yeah, they were real busy with this other project.
I was looking forward to throwing Mr. Howell right into the fire. First day.
I'm sure you would have been perfectly with this one, but I told him he can at least sit and watch, and the next one he'll be thrown to the fire.
That's right. All right, thank you very much. Okay, so let's talk commissioner reports, item 10, committee activities. Anybody have anything they want to share? As you heard, I had attended that grand opening for the SAFE program. It was great. Thank you guys for all the hard work and the efforts there. And also, I sent an email to Bruni today that volunteering to be on that YAC assessment process. So happy to join Commissioner Gidroyce on that. I think we both have done that in the past, too. So it's kind of enjoyable just so you guys know a lot of those young people have a desire and a heart for getting involved in the community. So it's a good thing. It's good to see our youth interested in civic activities and duties. And then finally, on that SAFE program, I just wanted to share that I did get to speak with a couple of the Valley Health board members that were there, and they encouraged me, and I'm sure they've encouraged you the same thing, to keep coming back for more, because they've got the funds, and these types of projects, like what we did at Lazy Creek Park, are exactly tailored for what the money is for. So health, fitness, wellness, all those kinds of things. So I'm going to say, as much as our maintenance folks are able to take on more projects, every park we have ought to have something similar to this. And just as a reminder, when we took our field trip and we were in Riverside and we saw that one park that had those fitness stations all the way around the tot lot playground in the circle shape where moms and dads can work out but their eyes are always on their kids, I think that was brilliant. And I'd like to see something like that maybe planned at some of those parks that are around here that have the tot lot and a sidewalk all the way around them. So anyway.
If I can give you just quick comment on that, some of the design services that we're soliciting for the through the contract for Lyle Marsh improvements would incorporate fitness stations as well as that universal playground idea. So that conceptual design will come back to you all to review before it goes any further. So.
Cool. Thank you for the update. Anything else from commissioners? Commissioner Gidroyce?
Could we have an update on Valleywide? Have we had any further meetings with them, with that HOA, anything?
Sure. There was a meeting with the HOA, the Menifee Masters Association, and Valleywide on Monday, I believe it was. And the discussion was mainly about what the HOA's obligation would be relative to the improvement plans and the ongoing maintenance of the areas. Just to give you a quick reminder, that corridor that is proposed for improvement, the plans that were submitted by Valleywide show both private property and the public right-of-way, which is currently maintained by the LMD, the Valleywide LMD. And so the city's perspective was the review and approval of those plans would just require us to understand that Valleywide has a recorded easement for the private property areas to clarify whether they were dedicated to the LMD for maintenance. And if not, then there had to be a solution or resolution before the city would, in good faith, be able to approve those plans because the utilities and irrigation systems are shared across private and public property. And so that's where it was. The outcome of the meeting, though, is we were going to look into a couple solutions. One was determine if easements had been recorded, as I mentioned. If not, the HOA would be considering the idea of dedicating those pieces, those parcels, either to Valleywide or to the district, I guess you could say. There was the idea of somehow on the plans a note to indemnify the city, essentially not knowing what the outcome might be of the easement research. The city would be able to approve the plans as submitted, however, ensure they're not culpable for whatever the findings might be after the fact. This way, it wouldn't hold up the progress of their plan. So our city attorney is working on some draft language for that right now.
Okay. Thank you. Good. Thanks for the update. Mm-hmm. And I'll just add, you know, there was an article and there were comments that were made in the article that kind of made this commission look like we failed our duty somehow. But I think we did exactly what we were supposed to do. The item was a discussion item. It was a receive and file. And it was a provide some recommendations. And that was one of the reasons why in our meeting minutes I wanted to add that we did in fact do the recommendations. But it was a receive and file item. And so for someone to make the statement that, you know, we somehow shirked our responsibilities by not taking some action on a discussion item, receive and file, I think that's a little bit hitting below the belt and a little unfair. So we don't need to feel bad. I think we did exactly what our responsibility was in this case.
Hidden below the belt, as was the whole evening.
Yeah.
I missed this article.
Show it to you. Okay, anything else? Who wants to vent? All right, who wants to get out of here? I do.
I move to adjourn.
There we go. Thank you. We are adjourned.